I recently received so many questions on my social media about shipping from Europe to Africa, especially from Italy to Africa, and I'm going to answer all the questions and explain everything in this video.
On this channel, I share videos about fashion, entrepreneurship, and how to juggle all this with a full-time job. If you like the sound of that,
welcome to my channel. My name is Hilda Gloria, but you can always call me Hilda Glosh. I do share videos about entrepreneurship every Wednesday and fashion every Sunday. So make sure you do subscribe if this is your first time. And if you are a new subscriber, welcome to the family. I live in Milan, Italy, and I run a small business that sells bags. It is called Triggy Bags, and since some of our customers are based in Africa, we do ship regularly to Africa. I will be taking you through the whole process of shipping from Europe to Africa, especially from Italy to Africa, all the way from buying the goods to packaging the goods until the goods actually reach the final customer. And I will be telling you about the companies, the different companies that actually carry out the shipping, the different companies that also offer concierge services, which are buying for the consumer and making sure that they ship the goods until they reach the consumer, how much it costs, whatever you need, what all the information that you need about shipping is going to be in this video, so stay tuned. These steps are really important. That is why I made sure that I highlight them for you, because they are so annoying. A bureaucratic country like Italy will send you back home if you miss any of these steps. So I would like you to not experience what I did in my first days of shipping. I used to get so frustrated, and I used to hate going to shipping companies because I knew it was not going to be a single trip. They were always looking for one thing after another. I'm glad to have compiled all these steps for you guys so that you don't have to go through what I had to go through. I'm going to be explaining this especially from my own point of view, from my own experience operating a bags company in Milan, Italy, and my experience is very relatable to all European countries, especially the ones in the EU. I'm not very sure about the UK, but I have some information about people that would like to ship from the UK. I also would like to say that shipping has been one of the main challenges in running my business, as it takes a long time. There are not so many options when it comes to shipping companies, especially from Italy to Uganda. Uganda being a landlocked country, there's lots of limitations. It is a little bit tricky. There are less companies as compared to countries like Senegal, Ghana, Kenya, countries that have got a cost. There are a few companies that ship directly from, you know, Italy to landlocked countries. Most of the companies do ship by water, but they do ship until a cost. So from the cost, you have got to find another company that has to deal with that. That makes it a lot of work. Also, shipping from Italy is not cheap compared to other countries. Now, I'm going to take you through the process, and I'm going to be focusing on Italy, like shipping from Italy to Africa, and I'm sure the other European countries can relate, especially the ones in the EU, because usually the rules and regulations are similar in the whole EU. So I'm going to be taking you through the whole process. Number one, once your goods are bought, they have to be measured, and make sure you have a list of all the goods with the value of the goods. By value of goods, I mean the prices of the goods, the amount of money that you have used to buy the goods. Sometimes they will ask you for an invoice or a receipt that shows the amount of money that you spent on these goods when you take the goods to the shipping company. Sometimes they will not ask you, depending on how you have classified these goods. You can ship goods as an individual giving out gifts, or you can ship goods as a business. You need to measure your goods, because once you take them to the shipping company, you will be charged either per kilo or per range of kilos. For example, usually from 0 to 5 kilos, there's a specific amount of money that you can pay, and if you have from 5 to 10 kilos, there's a specific amount of money that you have to pay depending on the company. Not all companies charge the same way. Now, once you have all the goods and you've written down a list of all the goods together with the cost of all the goods or the prices of all the goods, you need to pack them. But how do you pack them? In Europe, especially in Italy, you do not just pack goods in any box. If you are going to send goods, for example, using the post office, which is one of the means that you can use to ship, they have to be in boxes of certain dimensions. For example, if you are sending maximum that the post office can send to Africa, especially to Uganda, which is zone 3, they classify these countries into zones, and zone 3 has got Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, Tanzania, South Sudan, and Ethiopia. So if you are in that zone, the maximum you can send has to be 20 kilos per box. So a box of 20 kilos has to be a maximum of 200 centimeters in perimeter, and the maximum length per box has to be 100 centimeters. The box can be shaped in whatever way, it can be whatever size, but it has to have that perimeter. After you've packed your good, we then head on to sealing them. You have to make sure that you use waterproof and adhesive sellotape or tape that cannot easily be taken off. If it's taken off, the box is ripped, so that way they are sure that your goods will actually get home safe. Why do they need something that is waterproof? Because these things take so long on the journey to get home. Sometimes some of them actually take months, so they have to be sealed really well if you want them to get home intact. So what I do with my company is I use cardboard boxes, and I put in different layers of boxes on the bottom and on the top right before I seal them, just in case anything happens, just in case the boxes get ripped. I used to use double boxes just in case one gets ripped, my goods are still safe and sealed. So I would advise you to do the same, or make sure you've got a nice box and make sure you use very good tape. I'll put an example of the tape that is actually recommended in Italy here. From sealing, we go to labeling the package. How do we label the package? Usually it is a box, and you are required to put the sender's information on the top left hand corner of the box, and then the destination or the receiver's information on the bottom right corner of the box. If you mix up any of these things, a bureaucratic country like Italy will ask you to go back home and actually redo that, which is so annoying. I would like to add on that Italy is very bureaucratic. If one thing is missing, you are going to be asked to go back home to get it or to actually redo it, which is so annoying, especially if you have loads of boxes of goods that you would like to ship. So take very good care of these steps and make sure you do not have to make endless trips to the shipping companies. So filling in the forms, since I ship often, I have got the different forms of the shipping companies that I usually use. I've got them photocopied at home so that I can actually fill them at home when I'm calm, instead of filling them in at the shipping company where there's a bit of noise, there's a lot of stress, probably you'll find a lot of people and you would easily make a mistake. So what I do is I fill all these forms at home, either the night before or the day before or right before I actually go to these shipping companies. And when I get there, I have everything ready. That will help me make sure, because usually on the forms, they write down the list of documents that you need. If you are to fill them in at the company, there are chances that you might forget a document or something that is required or some important information. For example, they might ask for your passport number, and if you do not know your passport number and you, for example, left it at home, it would be a bit disturbing for you to have to actually come back. Also, you have to remember that when you're filling in the forms, you are going to be asked to declare the goods. So you will write, I have shipped, for example, 50 bags, and each bag has this value and each bag has this weight. So this is why in the beginning I asked you to write down a list of the goods, write down the value and the weight, so that when you get to the post office or when you get to filling this form, it is easy. It is a long form, so if you have variable goods that you are planning to ship, that would be a lot of work if you actually have to go back and forth to measure them or to check the receipts for how much they cost. It would be better if you had everything nicely organized on a piece of paper, written down as the good, the specific goods with the names, the invoice numbers, so that you make it easy for the goods to be tracked and shipped nicely. We don't have any space for losses, because if your shipment gets lost, where are you going to start from? They will first of all blame you for not having filled in the forms correctly. It will definitely be your fault, it will be up to you. You need that list also because the price or the cost of shipping is going to depend on the value of the goods and on the weight of the goods. So these are the determining factors for how much you are going to be charged. So after that is done, you go ahead and present your documents and you're good to be approved and shipped, and you will be given a receipt with a tracking number. Now that tracking number is very important. One, because you're going to give it to your customer to track their goods. And two, for the company, just in case anything happens to the goods, the company is able to track down to where the goods are, to track them down and actually find them for the customer, or to find them to from wherever they had shipped them. So make sure you keep the tracking number. It is very important. Also, because I usually use a tracking number when I'm sending the goods to my business clients in Africa, and those clients use the tracking number to collect the goods, especially if they're getting them from a post office or they need to collect them from cargo companies. They use these tracking numbers. So the tracking number is very important, and the receipt. The receipt is also a determining factor for how much in terms of taxes is the receiver going to pay. One thing that you have to be really careful about is reading the terms and conditions of the shipment. Who is paying what? Who is paying what? Usually when I'm sending the goods, if I'm sending to business clients, the customers have got a choice. Sometimes when I send goods, the price includes the shipping, so customers don't have to pay anything when receiving the goods. But when I'm sending the goods to our client in Kampala to sell or deliver the bags, she has got to pay a certain amount of money, which is called a collection fee. It also applies to Kenya, it applies to Rwanda, it applies to all the countries that I mentioned that are in zone 3. At customs, there is a tax to be paid. Whether these goods are gifts, or whether they are for business, or whether they're for resale, there's a tax to be paid as long as these goods are above $50. And the amount of tax depends again on the value of the goods, the weight of the goods, where they're coming from. Are they new? Are they old? Are they used? Are they gifts? Or these are goods meant for resale? So all these factors determine the amount of tax that the receiver or the person that is collecting the goods is supposed to pay. Now, companies. The companies that you can use to ship from Europe to Africa, especially from Italy, I mainly use the post office, because usually for my business clients, I send small boxes of maximum 20 kilos. They have got a requirement of maximum 20 kilos per box. And the value of the goods per box shouldn't exceed 250 euros. Also, they've got a limit of a range of the products that you can send by post office. For example, you cannot send gold through the post office. You cannot send chemicals through the post office. You cannot send live animals through the post office. These kind of goods can be handled by other companies. The value differs for different countries. For example, Kenya, the maximum value is 650 euros per box. And then for Senegal, it's 2,000 euros per box. So it's really, really different. For Uganda, it is 250 euros per box that the post office can send. So it's basically up to you to weigh up all these options. Look at the kinds of goods you would like to ship from Europe to Africa, the weight, how much, how often, because the more you use a company, the more you get to know about their promotions, the more you get discount codes and all these things. So for the post office, the charges to the zone 3 countries, where my main customer base is in Africa, charges 80 euros per 20 kilos for standard shipping, and that takes 21 days. And I like to maximize it to 20 kilos because that is the maximum, but it's actually a range from 15 to 20 kilos. I would rather pay 80 euros for 20 kilos than pay 80 euros for 15 kilos. Also, for express, they charge 150 euros between 15 and 20 kilos, and that arrives in 5 days. So depends on the urgency of a shipment. Otherwise, if you don't mind having your goods taking 21 days, you can consider standard delivery. And 1 kilo is 28 euros. It all takes 21 days if it is standard delivery, and it takes 5 days if it is express delivery. So the best option is to maximize the kilos, unless all you have to send is really urgent that you need to send something that is 1 kilo. If you are a business, I would suggest that you maximize the kilos to at least 20 kilos. With 20 kilos, you pay only 4 euros per kilo, but then with one, you pay 28 euros. So the more the weight, the less the price per kilo. So like I mentioned before, one of the disadvantages is that it takes really, really long with the post office. It has got limited goods, and it has got a limited value. Now, when the goods get to the destination, they will definitely be received by the post office of that local area or of the country or of the city where the client is. And the client will receive a notification message and they will be able to go and collect the goods. And by collecting the goods, like I mentioned earlier, if the goods are more than $50 of value, they will have to pay a certain tax. Option number two is using cargo by airlines. Now, there's lots of airlines in Italy and in Europe that actually fly daily to Africa. We've got Brussels, we've got Egypt Air, we've got Ethiopian Airlines, just to mention a few. All these companies have got their own cargo, but of course it is a bit more expensive compared to the post office. And they have got lots of, you know, advantages. The goods arrive within a night or actually just hours or a few days and spend, say, a day or two, you know, in the handling services, and then you actually get your goods. You instantly get the goods, basically. It has got a wider range in terms of kilos, in terms of products, in terms of value. You can send gold using an airline. You can send lots of valuable goods. You can send a live animal. You can send chemicals. You can send weapons, you can send anything on an airplane, but you cannot send these using the post office. It is the fastest means. I would recommend it. The downside is that it is really expensive. The last time that I checked with the cargo company, it charged €9 per kilo, and the minimum weight that they were taking was 50 kilograms. Have to consider all these are factors that you have got to consider. Look at your business, look at your intention, and consider them before you actually consider or before you decide a shipping company. There is also cargo by ship, but those mainly are beneficial for people that have got countries that have got a coast or have got a sea or ocean. For example, Kenya, Tanzania, they do benefit a lot from these. Senegal, and they are actually way cheaper than the other means. The downside is that it takes at least 1.5 months for the goods to get home, but it is way cheaper. They could send containers. It is way cheaper that way. Unfortunately, for the countries that are landlocked, like Uganda, you have got to find another company to clear the goods from, for example, Mombasa, from a port, and actually transport them to your home country, which makes it a little bit more expensive. But it is the best option if you've got containers, if you've got lots. For example, if you would like to ship building equipment that is so bulky and in huge quantities, that would be the best option. For the water cargo, I know a company called MSC that I would recommend. Is a good company. It ships from Italy, and it ships like that you could buy from Europe and have shipped to Africa. And it's such a huge company. It's a multinational company, so it has got also a concierge bit of it that it could buy for you from any European country in the EU, and it could ship on your behalf. Of course, there has to be costs involved. And then option four is our very own. It's called Salabed. They've got a branch in Uganda and it does wonders, but unfortunately it's not in Italy. It's not in Italy. I have tried them, and the last time that I did contact them and inquired from them, they had very good rates about it's only convenient if you'd like to ship from the UK. I'm not sure about Sweden. It used to be in Sweden before. I'm not sure right now. It also used to have a branch in Germany, but that I'm not very sure about. I am pretty sure they do have a branch in the UK. They could buy on your behalf and actually ship for you, and you get the goods ready in Kampala. I am sure they are in Kenya. I'm not sure about any other African countries that they're in, but their services are great. I've had them ship for me some stuff from the UK. They weren't, first of all, the goods arrived in about 2 weeks. They were on time, and their prices are really good, and they shipped a huge bulk of stuff. So yes, I would recommend Salabed. What I would like to mention is that all the companies follow the same process that I mentioned earlier on. So it is basically the same. They will give you a tracking number once your goods arrive in the country of destination. They will give you a notice and you will have to go and pick them up. Otherwise, you can pay for a courier to have them delivered to your house. The other options are the international companies like DHL, UPS, but these are so expensive. Unless it is urgent. I remember I had a letter shipped to me at €150. That is a lot of money. So for just a letter that was less than a kilo. So DHL is super expensive. But as always, if you have lots of kilos that you'd like to ship and on time, why not consider it? I hope that has answered most of your questions about shipping. If you have any more questions, let me know in the comment section below. and I will be glad to answer them or actually find a solution to them. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe for more informative videos like this one. Give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!